You never know what to expect here on the corner of Market and... Oh, wait, I have to check this. Text. More like textile. OMG, make sure everyone finds out more tonight on NEOtropolis, not business as usual. Welcome to NEOtropolis. We are not business as usual. Hi, I'm your host, Jim Evans. You know, everything we do here on our show is by design, most of the time. And tonight we'll spend some time on a unique business in Northeast Ohio that is all about design, as in clothing. And through a combination of passion, experience, and hard work, the owner of this business has received regional recognition for her standout work. And if her product is not already a part of your fashion file, it just might be by the time we close. So stay with us. Right now, we'll try on regional business news from the NEOtropolis Good Business News Aggregator.
This is the Good Business News along the I-77 corridor for the week of July 25th. Monday's Cleveland Plain Dealer Metro section reports that New York-based Leveraging Investments in Creativity has awarded Cleveland Advocacy Group, the Community Partnership for Arts and Culture, a $500,000 grant to provide small loans to help artists buy and renovate homes in Cleveland's growing East Side Arts and Entertainment District. Tuesday's Cleveland Plain Dealer Business Section and Wednesday's Akron Beacon Journal Business Section reports that Cleveland-based Eaton Corporation, a global and diversified manufacturer of power systems, reports that projected sales this year will top its 2008 record. The company attributes the growth to the rise in cost of energy that is forcing customers to invest in energy-efficient systems that Eaton manufactures. Also, Tuesday's Cleveland Plain Dealer Business Section reports that Medina-based RPM International Incorporated, a global manufacturer of specialty coatings, sealants, and building materials, is reporting strong growth in sales and profits for its fourth quarter. Tuesday's Akron Beacon Journal Business Section reports that in June, the Akron-Canton Airport topped its 2008 passenger record by 1,358 customers. For the first half of this year, the airport has served 3.4% more travelers from the same time period last year. Wednesday's Kent Record Courier Local and State section reports that according to the 2011 Chronicle of Higher Education's list of great colleges to work for, Kent State University was named as one of the 10 best universities in the category of compensation and benefits among schools with an enrollment of more than 10,000 students. Thursday's Cleveland Plain Dealer Business Section reports that Elyria-based Bendix Commercial Vehicle Systems will purchase the vehicle sensor division of California-based electronics company Iteris. The $14 million purchase will give Bendix a lane departure warning system that will alert drowsy drivers if they are drifting out of their lane, and a data management system that will allow monitoring of driving practices. And Thursday's Cleveland Plain Dealer Business Section reports that Garfield Heights-based Chart Industries, a global manufacturer of massive machinery, engineered hardware fittings and components to liquefy gas, as well as having a biomedical division, reports an increase in sales and anticipates a strong future. Chart Industries attributes the positive report and forecast to a global increase in the use of natural gas. Also, Thursday's Cleveland Plain Dealer Business Section reports that Cuyahoga Falls-based AmeriChem Incorporated, a provider of color and additives for synthetic fibers, has doubled its plant's operational space locally in addition to adding a production line at its plant in the United Kingdom. And finally, Thursday's Cleveland Plain Dealer Business Section reports that Independence-based CBiz Incorporated, a business services company, has reported a 20% increase in net income for its second quarter ending June 30th compared to the same time period last year. This is the Good Business News along the I-77 corridor for this week. NEOtropolis is your source for good business news.
Our dress code for this evening, special casual. However, our crew didn't get the memo. They still look good, though. But tonight's show just may allow you to make an artistic, creative statement that is all about you. And that is the mission of a fashion business in the region that implements an ancient Japanese technique that enhances fabric and colors with unusual depth and variations. And you need to see the fall line. We get you to that in a few moments. But next in line for us is our content partner, the Business Journal. It's time for the Weekly Buzz.
I'm Stacia Ertis with the Business Journal Weekly Buzz for Youngstown and the Mahoning Valley. A big expansion for Wheatland Tube in Howland in Trumbull County. The state has approved a 40% job creation tax credit over 6 years for the project that will involve an investment of $11.4 million and create 20 jobs. It will help Wheatland Tube increase production and efficiencies in the oil tubular goods market related to the Marcellus and Utica shale exploration. The regional chamber says the new jobs will create nearly $800,000 in additional annual payroll. Currently, the Howland plant employs 143 people. Thousands of people got the chance to see inside the General Motors Lordstown plant this week. Some 9,000 people registered for the opportunity to see how the Cruise is produced and to catch a glimpse of the 2012 Cruise, the Chevy Volt, and other new models.
Well, without taxpayers' help, we're not here today. So wanted to say thank you, America. Thanks to all the taxpayers.
Team NEO could wind up as the development office for the region under Governor John Kasich's Jobs Ohio plan. The Youngstown-Warren Regional Chamber helped establish Team NEO in 2003 to promote economic development in Northeast Ohio, and Chamber President Tom Humphrey serves on the board. Under the plan, Team NEO would work with groups to help them prepare proposals to take to the state for funding and incentives. The Raymond John Wien Foundation unveils plans for its new home. The Wien Foundation is restoring the 17,000-square-foot building on West Market Street in Warren. It's an important element for the revitalization of Courthouse Square.
Today really marks the occasion where the Raymond John Wien Foundation is making a significant community investment in Warren, but really in the Valley. We're very excited about this, as it will give us new foundation offices, the permanent home of the Wien Foundation.
Two Valley post office branches are on the list for possible closure. This branch off Belmont Avenue on Youngstown's north side is one of some 3,700 offices nationwide being considered for closure or consolidation. The other branch is in Calcutta in Columbiana County. This new bottom dollar food store being built on Youngstown's south side is one of 14 it plans to open here and in the greater Pittsburgh area in early 2012. Along with this store, Bottom Dollar is opening two other stores in the city. Bottom Dollar is based in North Carolina and is a subsidiary of the Belgium Del Hayes Company. It was lights, camera, action for home savings and loan. Aspiring actors turned out at Accent Media downtown for a local casting call. Home Savings is looking for good local talent for their upcoming fall television commercials. And those are this week's headlines. Be sure to check out the Buzz Newscast every business day online at businessjournaldaily.com.
And now it's time for a NEOtropolis fact.
Did you know that 16 cardiovascular companies moved to the Northeast Ohio region in the past 2 years?
I have to say that our show this evening is a work of art. Actually, it's the work of the art of cloth. And that is a special fashion company in Chagrin Falls led by Rose Corrick, owner and artist. And her artistry has been so unique that she was named to a recent list as one of the top 10 women business owners of Northeast Ohio. Rose is passionate about her craft and says you have to be ready to make bold moves to grow your business. So we now move ahead with Jennifer Borres, who I know placed an order, and she shows us this truly unique success story.
A company located in Chagrin Falls called The Art of Cloth designs unique clothing just like this and sells them locally and across the country. And they are definitely not business as usual.
Because if we just had nickel next to this chocolate, it would not match. So
we are a design studio as well as a clothing manufacturer. And we design and process a line of hand-dyed women's clothing for boutiques around the country and one department store, Dillard's.
That all takes place in-house at this manufacturing facility where they sew and create sample designs.
The designs go out to sewers, and we have outside sewers who fabricate what we call blanks. So the garments are made into blanks of either black or white fabric. And then the blanks come back into our company and we process them.
Which includes dyeing, printing, taking color out, or putting color back in.
So we have this whole process of what we call surface design, where we're impacting the surface of the cloth. So this started out as a piece of white fabric, and then we We have a garment made, we dye it, and then we print it.
Then half a dozen reps around the country show clothes at trade shows. Boutiques then place their orders, and they are filled right here.
The idea of hand-dyed clothing is certainly out there, and there's a lot of craftspeople, artists who do similar things to what we do. I think what's unique about us is that we are in the commercial apparel world. So our work, our goal is to bring good design to the world and beautiful textiles to the world.
That's something Rose has always wanted to do.
I have a degree in textile design, so I've been a fabric lover since I was, you know, very small. And I come from a whole line of women who worked with their hands and worked with textiles. My mother is 88 years young, and she is a textile artist herself. She taught me how to sew. And as I got into dyeing later in life, I brought her into the process. So now she sews and dyes as well. And so the piece that you see in the background actually is a wall piece that my mother and I made together here a couple years ago in the studio.
But she says as a textile design major, she wasn't quite sure what to do with it.
So I had this love of textiles, and I went to school at the University of Minnesota and in Oslo, Norway, studying textiles. And when I graduated, I didn't quite know how to make a career out of it, though. So I gravitated to interior design instead and was a commercial interior designer for 25 years, all the while loving textiles. So when the fabric reps would come in, I would be passionate about all the textiles. Sometimes, you know, they have this, what they call a midlife crisis, and I had mine in my mid-40s, and I left my company at the time and that I had created in interior design. And I decided I needed to pursue my lifelong passion for textiles.
So Rose went back and relearned her art, studying with artists across the country, and suddenly an interest in her clothing grew.
I didn't want to be a fashion designer because I was a textile designer. But somehow when the universe calls and tells you, you know, eventually I had to respond. There's a story about me literally selling the shirt off my back in a church parking lot. A woman wanted that shirt right now off my back. And I always say thank God for layering because I had a turtleneck underneath.
She finally said yes to apparel and started to sell from her home and at art craft shows until she realized she could take it to the commercial markets. Art of Cloth now makes between 1,500 and 2,000 garments a month. Fine Points Incorporated in Cleveland is one of the boutiques that buys and sells her garments.
Well, we're very definitely into color. I would say that if a person came to Fine Points, looked around and left, I would think that they would remember the color over everything. And that's why Art of Cloth is so representative of what we think is important.
And the owner of Fine Points says they've been selling Art of Cloth garments since the beginning.
A mutual acquaintance introduced us when I was just in the developing early part of my business, and that was over 20 years ago, and we were friends. And at that time, Rose was doing interiors. And once in a while, she would dabble in wearables, and I kept putting pressure on my friend, Rose, to do wearables because I thought she had a knack for it.
Well, I began wholesaling in 2006, so I incorporated in 2000, but it took a long time of trying to figure it out, how to make this love of mine into something that was feasible and maybe even profitable. It has been a really challenging road because the challenges, I guess, are first how to be consistent in the work that we do so that when a buyer places an order for garments, they want to know that they're going to get the same thing. And so working out systems so that we can become more production-oriented was a big shift for someone like myself who was an artist. And I liked doing this, and I liked doing that, and making 100 of them, not so much.
Since then, they've learned how to produce garments consistently in their studio, but another problem was being profitable.
With the economy, there's huge price resistance, as you know. You know, the crash in 2008 affected us dramatically, and we're a higher-end product. So when dollars are tight, how do we make the profit we need to make to sustain us, and how do we deliver a product to our customers that they can afford?
Rose says her relationship with her customers is very important.
I adore our customers. I say that somewhere along the line of loving textiles and the process of creating these fabrics, somewhere along the line I fell in love with my customer, you know, and that I think was the biggest shift in our business, what created the business. When I began connecting with the women who love our work, you know, there's sort of an intangible here. Do they know exactly why they love an Art of Cloth piece? I don't, most of them don't, but I get emails from all women all over the country who just tell me how great they feel in our clothes. I make them feel good about themselves. We kind of give women permission to express themselves creatively.
Despite the initial challenges, Art of Cloth has flourished, and J.R. Campbell, director of the fashion school at Kent State University, thinks it may be partly due to Rose's business approach.
But I think what's really unique about Rose's approach is that in addition to showing their product and wholesaling to a number of small boutique retailers, she also has an account with Dillard's and shows the work in a venue that's normally a divide for that kind of a business. Usually you can only work in one or the other, and part of that's because usually the retailers stipulate who you can work with. And so I think what is unique about her business is really how she's bridged a few different worlds, bridged the gaps to make it happen. I think that's partly because of her own motivation and ambition, but I think it also helps to be not in the center of the fashion industry to do something like that. So maybe there's a link to being in Northeast Ohio that allows her to be a bit more flexible.
I love being in Northeast Ohio. I love being in Chagrin Falls. I think it's really, really awesome that we are this little presence here in Northeast Ohio. We have some wonderful seamstresses who work out of their homes, who work for us, who are fabulous. Kent State has an incredible fashion design program, number 3 in the world, I understand. We have a couple of their graduates working with us. So there are more resources here than I used to think. And I think that I'm really, really proud to, you know, be working in Northeast Ohio, employing 12 women in Northeast Ohio who work here, and also to work with contractors here. And we do a lot. We try to keep it to our area a lot, and certainly in the U.S.
We're seeing a lot of newer or startup businesses. So, but generally, most of our grads are going out of state and certainly out of the region to if they're in design. So yes, it gives an opportunity for some of our students to stay here.
So we've got this wonderful group of artisans who have degrees in art, graphic design, textile design, fashion design. So we not only have this internally where we have this great community of people, but I think that the possibility of what we share with these women I mentioned earlier is just goes beyond a piece of clothing. And I think that's the part that really speaks to me.
Right now, Art of Cloth is working on a new line, a combination of resort / holiday / pre-spring, which will go to markets very soon.
I have plans to get into some catalog work so that we can just have some other avenues for selling. I also, we're working on redoing our website so that we can have some, we have many, many, many people asking us if we can buy online. And I'm very conscious of not competing with our stores, so we might come up with something where we're selling direct to the public and have a different avenue for people to access our work. So I think that's an exciting possibility. We are talking about coming up with another label, another brand other than Art of Cloth, so we can have a slightly different look and another market for our work. So there's just always new and exciting things that we're looking at to develop.
Art of Cloth has a sample sale just a few times a year right here at their manufacturing facility where you can buy clothing just like this. And the next one is coming up in the beginning of August. In Chagrin Falls, I'm Jennifer Boris for Western Reserve PBS.
Looks like a colorful future for the Art of Cloth. And with that, it's time now for Into the Future.
Into the Future.
Hello. I'm Sabrina Schweier from nationally acclaimed landscape design and development group Salisbury Schweier, based in Akron, Ohio. When I first met my husband and partner, Samuel Salisbury, we decided that we had very different backgrounds and talents, but we shared a common vision. So we created Salisbury Schweier to be able to provide clients with landscapes that were gorgeous, that were sustainable, and that were very deeply spiritual, transforming their lives. When our clients come to us, they recognize that we have these three opportunities that we can bring them and that we can deliver. Salisbury Schweyer Gardens are gorgeous. They are personal, individualized works of art. Salisbury Schweyer landscapes are sustainable, sensitive to the earth. And thirdly, Salisbury Schweyer Gardens are transformational, spiritual places where they can express themselves and attune themselves with nature in a very real and deep sense. So Salisbury Schweyer provides lots and lots of opportunities, whether large or small, public or private, to have something that is an individual garden, work of art. To reach Salisbury Schweyer, contact us at www.ssigardens.com, or you also may follow us on Facebook.
You know, we always like to give you some news on the financial field, and the experts at NCA Financial Planners do that now with a stock wrap.
This week's local company spotlight is First Energy Corporation, headquartered in Akron, Ohio. First Energy operates as a diversified energy company producing electricity from a fleet of nuclear, coal, natural gas, and hydro plants. Through its subsidiaries and affiliates, First Energy covers 67,000 square miles in Ohio, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, West Virginia, and Maryland, and employs just over 13,000 people. The company was formed in 1997 through the merger of Ohio Edison and Centurion Energy Corporation. The merger with Allegheny Energy was recently completed in February of 2011, which created the largest investor-owned electric system serving 6 million customers. First Energy trades on the New York Stock Exchange under the symbol FE and pays a quarterly dividend of 55 cents per share, equating to about a 5% dividend yield. The midweek close for First Energy was $45.13, while year-to-date the stock is positive 21.91%. The last 5 years, First Energy is negative 18.61. Back to you, Jim.
You always want to look your best for culture and entertainment in Northeast Ohio. That is always in fashion. And we have the guy who makes it an art form. Cool Cleveland's Thomas Moretti joins us now to tell you about some other events that are going on in NEOtropolis this weekend. What we're talking about is the business of fun.
Hey, it's Thomas Mulready from CoolCleveland.com, and we're here today in Lakewood at the Root Cafe, and we're talking this week about local cafes and coffee shops in Northeast Ohio. There's a lot of great local places you can go, not only to get your coffee, but also to get art and music. For example, right here at the Root Cafe in Lakewood, they specialize in vegetarian as well as vegan cuisine. And they're doing that lunch, they're doing a dinner time, and then on Sundays they've got a brunch. And also right here in Lakewood, Bella Dubby is a great little coffee shop. Not only coffee, they've got probably hundreds of beers. They specialize in microbrews. They've got local Brooklyn beer on tap. And they do art on the walls, and they do music. They do a lot of really great touring bands come through Bella Dubby in Lakewood. The Rose Cafe in Lakewood Beach, Lakeview Beach, in Lorain, is right on the lake, and they've got a full menu, salads, burgers, paninis, great location. If you head down to Akron, we're going to recommend Mocha Maiden Coffee. They've got wine, and right next door is the Wee Gallery, where they've got art on the walls and local artists being featured. And right next door is Rubber City Clothing, so it's a great local area right in the historic district of Akron. Then you head over to Canfield, which is just outside of Youngstown, and the Peaberry Cafe and Bakery, made from scratch European pastries, which actually is sort of made from Youngstown, I guess you would call it. But, you know, that's awesome, and it's the Peaberry Cafe and Bakery in Canfield. They also have sandwiches and soups. So check out your local cafes and coffee shops in Northeast Ohio. This is Thomas Mulready from CoolCleveland.com. Have a great week in NEOtropolis.
As we leave you, keep in mind there are things that you can do to help the Northeast Ohio economy. One great way is to get out to any of the events Thomas told us about and make your investment in fun. You can also position yourself out there and make some brilliant comments about the Northeast Ohio economy to the people in line for the fitting room and tell them to spread the word. Also, remember to log on to our website, neotropolis.org, and tell us what you think. I'm Jim Evans. Thanks for joining us here on NEOtropolis, not business as usual.
Funding for NEOtropolis has been provided by the Burton D. Morgan Foundation, committed to the free enterprise system.
First Place Bank is proud to sponsor NEOtropolis. As a community bank, First Place Bank believes we are only as strong as the communities we serve. Locally owned businesses are the cornerstone of our communities. We concentrate on helping local businesses make the most of their resources through a variety of services delivered with a community banking touch.
The Dominion Foundation. JumpStart, working with entrepreneurs to accelerate the growth of their high potential businesses to create a more prosperous economic future for Northeast Ohio. Youngstown Business Incubator. And NorTech.